right, guys. Well, we're going to start this up. In preparation for this, I have my old safety glasses here that I think they belong to, like, my dad, perhaps. But I also got in the mail this morning. That's where everything's coming from, the mail. In the mail this morning, I got a pair of safety glasses from Duluth Trading Company that I think are pretty primo. You notice they have, like, these little screens that go on the sides there. Goes over top of my head. It goes over like that. I hope you can take me seriously when I'm wearing these. But anyways, I had fun delivering all this stuff to you guys. I apologize, teenagers, for me waking you up at 9 something in the morning with a doorbell. Drew, your poor sister. Kevin, sorry about that, buddy. Chara, you should be thankful for your grandparents taking care of that for you. And Elijah, I met your family. Yeah, Elijah had the tough issue of having two tires that were flat at work. So his mom and his, I'm not sure who else that was, Elijah, who the guy was. But anyways, very good, guys. I gave you guys the parts for this. And, you know, I cut out a lot, and as much processing as I was doing, I was thinking, boy, am I doing too much of this project for them? And the answer is maybe. But I wanted to make sure that what we were focused on here was the joinery. You know, one thing that is really cool to me, and it's the kind of thing that you can do by yourself, is like to practice different joinery, because there's a neatness to it. And with this joint we're doing here for the Sawhorse, it's cool. It's a cool joint, and it teaches you a lot about layout and how, if you're going to be using chisels to clean things out and so forth, how to get it just right, okay? And I gave you guys all some Japanese saws that are going to be very helpful for us to get this how we want it to be. What I didn't, by the way, Drew, where you live, I used to live right around the corner from you. So, like, if you go to the end of your street, not towards Fleetwood, but, like, towards the end there, there's that ranch house there, and if you turn left, you go down back down to Main Street there. Well, when you get to Main Street, turn right, and the second house there, Stone House, is where my mom grew up as a kid. The one right on the corner there is where my grandmother grew up as a kid, and where I always went as a kid going when I came out to see my grandparents for Christmas and so forth. So it was cool. It's cool to see. That little strip there is really neat where you don't have a lot of traffic. But anyways, I want to get the plans that they gave us here, so I'm reading exactly what you have too. And then I'll also talk about some other things that I've changed around just slightly or illustrated a little bit more clearly. So this thing these horses must be pretty sweet, because this guy, he first saw this in 87, and he's been like making them for himself. And so what I'm saying is the design has evolved by a woodworker who's a pretty good woodworker. So kind of cool to get these things together here. So it talks about how he did all these drawings on CAD. If you need to be able to see any of these dimensions better, you got to go to this website here. And it's pretty easy to find. Just Google the title to it. Build a classic Sawhorse, and then comma, fine woodworking, and it comes up. So you can get all this stuff on there. But anyways, we have our legs coming out at 75 degree angles in both directions. So it's a compound miter joint, meaning that 75 this way and 75 this way. So there's two 75s on there, which makes the joint a little bit more complicated and a little bit cooler for us to be doing. What are they saying here? So preparing the saddle first. Start by milling up your lumber. I've done that for you. My horses are not going to be 42 inches exactly, because I didn't have the material to get 42 inches for my tops. You guys got the primo lumber. I took what was left over afterwards. I'm going to try to make do with what I had. But says that he used redwood in where he's living, because he could set them outside and he could be outside for a while. That's great. That would be really nice. For us to make them out of Spanish cedar would be really nice. For us to make them out of pine is pretty good. I'll be honest with you, these Sawhorses that we're making, especially like Chara, I think your legs are made out of maple. they're not going to be great to just have them sitting out in the rain all the time. So if you can put them up in like the rafters of a garage or something like that, that would work well for them. Just try to keep them somewhat out of the elements. But you know what? If they're in the elements, so what? They're sawhorses. They won't last your entire life. You'll be doing this again in 10 years. But, you know, this is kind of fun. So, prepare the lumber by cutting each the size of the table saw or bandsaw, then joint each face, plan the thickness, blah, 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 blah. So, like, when you read this, you see an inch and a half, immediately it might, and 5.5 inches wide. Immediately what you're thinking is, well, I'll just buy a 2x6, and I'll get my 5.5 inches out of that. Well, 2x6s are going to warp if they haven't by the time you've already bought them. So you're not going to get an inch and a half out of that once you've joined that and planed that. So really, the way we're doing this is a good way of doing this by using good lumber that I've already jointed and planed, and it's been kiln dried and blah blah blah. They're going to work out to be good horses for a while. cut the size, 2 supply joinery templates. So these templates here that I gave you are what is this going to be, but I don't necessarily want you to use this. I have this as a visual aid to see that what you're drawing on here is right, but to just copy it off of this is, number one, is I don't think it's going to be as accurate as what we're doing, and number two, it's not going to teach you as much. So have this as just an aid so we can remember which way those 4-degree angles, these little jobbies here, are going when we go into this thing. Because it's easy to get messed up. I have marked on the one side here that this is the end of the board, so that's going to be, when we put this down, this is my sawhorse top. That would be going towards the end, so I can recognize which ways are going. So my angles here, which way the 4 degrees will be going this way, and this one as well, okay? So that's that. Here is one that I cut up as an example. In your box that I gave you, there's a 5.5 by whatever the length is I was able to give you. And that is for practice. That's for you to be able to try these joints out. I tried both these cuts out using different techniques, and I decided on one as the one that we were gonna use in here. So that's why I went back and got the Japanese saws for you, because I think it does the nicest, most accurate job of cutting out those compound miters on there. I gave you the back saw because the teeth on these are really fine. So I want you to be careful, because a new blade for this costs about $30. And they get to the point where, if I show you, here's one that I took off my saw just last week. Because it had gotten to the point where it wasn't worth keeping on any longer. But you can see, or maybe you can't see, there are areas here, like all through here, where the teeth are all banged off. It still works. It still works better than a lot of saws I have, which is why I just keep it around, just in case I want to use it for something. But it comes right off of this thing. It comes out. These come out just by tapping them down. And the blade starts to come off. Now, I don't want to do that, so I'm going to knock it back. So it sits back where it's supposed to be. But they just hinge out like that. So they're pretty easy to change the blades on, but the blades do cost money, and the saw to begin with costs a fair amount of money. So just be careful with it, because I am going to collect these back again in June from you guys. All right? All right, so when we're laying this out, let's see how they want this to be. They have this section here being 3.5 inches up to the front there, all right? So to start off, what I'm going to do is I'm going to take the square that I gave you guys. And where did they mark that? You can see that in the drawing here. I marked that as 3.5 inches back from the edge. So 3.5 inches, one thing it does real well is you can all see 3.5 inches here. It's to scale this thing that I gave you guys. But 3.5 inches is where it's gonna hit. So things that we should have right now, or let's just go ahead and decide which side is going to be up, which side is going to be down. I am going to have it be that, because of that notch there, I'm going to have that be my downside, so I'm going to do my top on this side here. So notice also on this thing here, that one side of the cutout here goes in 3/4 of an inch. And the other one only goes in 3/8. Well, the reason is because when the legs go on this thing, they're at an angle, right? So they go in further at the top than they do at the bottom there. So I marked that one is the top cut and one is the bottom cut. And I'll show you that as we're going along here. But first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to set my my combination square to 3.5 inches. So I'll bring that all the way in to 3.5 inches there. And I'm going to cover up the 3.5 inch line. So that looks like this. Okay, and that's going to give my 3.5 inches. Now, next thing I want to do is I want to mark in from the ends on all these tops here. Ooh, one thing I don't like is this. See that starting to crack there? And my 3.5 comes kind of right to that. Looks like it's going to be not side up for me, people. There was that one crack in the corner there. This is lumber that I just found laying around. This is, you see the green by the knot there, so we can tell this is poplar. So I'm going to use this side up. So the one tool that I didn't give you guys, because it's ultra dangerous, I gave you a chisel, which is probably one of the most dangerous tools in the shop here, but I did not give you guys a utility knife. Okay, so if you have one at home, use it, okay? There's going to be a lot more accurate than using a sharp pencil when we're doing this. So if you have one, use the utility knife. If you don't have one, well, we're at the improvise as we go along here. Probably use the chisel for a lot of stuff. But if you have one, we're going to use this to do all of our marks. So I'm going to mark, and here's the setup that we're going to use primarily. I don't know how long I'll be using this for, because I'm going to cut on the sides here. But if we set this thing, so when we run this around, turn it one way and you'll see that it starts opening up the jaws. And by rolling it out like this, we're rolling both screws at the same time. Then we can set our board right in there like that and bring them closed at the same time. So that they're clamping on it like one big vise, table vise. Okay? Okay, now you say to yourself, well, but now it's just the whole thing rides around here. Well, I also gave you a clamp. Take your clamp and clamp it to the tabletop and hold that nice and tight. So now, this is on there, okay? This is on there well, and I can go ahead and do all my markings and not worry about the board shifting as I'm doing this. So it goes like this. I'll bring it over here. And I bring that down to the edge there, and I'm gonna go right along the edge here. So I'm gonna bring it a little closer actually to do this. So when I hold this here, I'm gonna hold that to the edge, and then I'm gonna go right to the edge of the square that I have here and make a mark. The same thing, flip it to the other side, I'm gonna go right to the edge and make a mark. So you see my two marks here? The same thing on the opposite side. Right here, make a mark. Right here, and make a mark. Okay? The reason that we come in 3.5 inches is we want that big solid mass on the end there to help be on the joint to help this thing, the legs, from crushing out that area there. So that's 3.5 inches. Now, I'm not going to use the pattern here. I want to use the actual width of my piece, my leg that I'm going to be using here. So that's important, okay? So because that's going to be 5.5 inches, we want to use that as our example. I actually have to make more legs for myself. Let me see if I can grab something here. By the way, you can see I have done a few practices. If you guys want more practice wood, I'll give you more practice wood. I'm going to take off one of these legs here and use this. So here's one of the legs. I already did one of the horses over there. Here's one of the legs that I'm going to show you here. So I have that end marked there, and I also have my 75 degree angle, which we're going to set up right now. So this thing is called a sliding T-bevel. And I also gave you an angle guide here. So you're going to go ahead and get that angle set to, and I'll go ahead and loosen mine so I can show you the whole process. So now it's kind of loosey-goosey. I'm going to get it just semi-tight so I can still tweak it. So I can put it right to the edge there. I can bring this down. Line that up and tighten that. And then just check one last time and see if it stayed where you wanted it to. So there's my 75 degree angle. Okay? So I got this thing all set up for this width, but the reality is I want to flip it. So I'm going to loosen these two up here. And I want to actually bring this all in. This is kind of a pain in the butt to do this because we have to bring these jaws in while they're flat. Let me put you back where you can see what's going on here. I'm just bringing my jaws in to clamp the thickness of the board instead of the width. It's easier to do with a bench vise, I know, but I think that when you guys have this set up on here, you're going to say to yourself, this is actually a really sturdy way of clamping things to the tabletop. So you can buy one of these parallel, all these parallel clamps that I have, like the one that I have that I'm using right now, is one that I bought at Leesport Farmers Market. Leesport Farmers, whatever, the flea market that they have there. I bought it for, I think it was like $9. Maybe more, but I think $9, very honestly. So now that's in there just as well. So what I want to do is, I want to try to think about, again, which way the angles are going to go. So the angles are going to go, my legs are going to come out front from that. So that 75 degree angle is going to go forward, correct? So here's my 75 degree angle. I'm going to put my knife right where I marked that 3.5 inches, and I am going to bring it so that the angle is going out from that. And I'm going to go ahead and knife that lightly, and I'll knife it again. So what I've created now is I had the 3.5 mark, and now I've cut this 75 degree angle on here. So what's the purpose? What's the reason for doing that? Or how can I mark the other end? I can lay my 3.5 inch piece right on this. And I'm actually going to get this piece over here as well. So I'm setting up another piece here. And for you, you just be setting up your other leg. Just like that. So I can lay this across. So now it lays flat across this thing. I don't have to worry about balancing the leg when I'm doing this. And I'm going to line my 5. Now remember, these legs here are tapered. They get thinner. But up at the top, there's an 8-inch section that's going to be parallel, the edges. So I'm going to lay that 8-inch section there right on the line. Just like so. And I'm going to make a really small cut. So when I say really small cut, I mean, there's my cut there, and there's my really small cut there. I want it really small because I want to make the full cut, because if I try to go down there, use that as my straight edge, I run the risk of this thing kind of shuffling on me and my line not being perfect. But if I just made a little mark, I can go ahead now and put my knife right in that little mark. It falls right into the little groove there. And then I can go ahead and bring my bevel gauge right up to it and make that mark there. So now what you're seeing are two parallel lines, right? And those two parallel lines are exactly the width of my leg. So that's how I want that. Okay, so I have my 75 degree angles marked. I'm gonna go around, or you know what, for your practice piece, just do this one. Just one right there. But I'm also gonna do this. The chisel that I gave you, I don't know what size they gave you. I had 1 inches and 3/4 inches. But we want to be able to knock out these pieces in like partitions. So we want to have it be that, you know, I'm just going to put my chisel here and I'm going to mark just a hair bit wider than what that is for all these. These are going to be my practice cuts later on. So now I'll take my 75 degree angle. And this time I'm not really worried about accuracy because these are just a hog out material. So I'm going to do these with a pencil. Okay. So that side's done now. I have all those 75 degree angles marked on that. The only thing that remains are going to be my 4 degree angle marks that we're going to be doing next. Let me see if this is correct with what I've been saying on my, I wrote down some instructions that I was doing before. So 3 inch, 3.5 inch combination square come in from all the ends. Clamp it on its edge into the 75 degree angle sloping from towards the ends. Lay width of the legs along line and scratch the width small. Lay width of the legs. Yeah, we did that. So we did our second width of our leg on here. We scratched our second line. Now you have marks for the full width, the top, bottom. Now knife out angles and widths. Keep in mind the angles are 4 degrees and go in certain directions. So now, again, this would all be a lot simpler if we all had table vices. Chair, I guess you do, but not everybody's so lucky. And that is what I told my my good buddy when his wife called up and said, my husband is thinking about doing more woodworking. What does he need to buy? And she's an orthopedic surgeon, she works in the surgery center, and she helps diagnose things with orthopedics. But anyways, she was looking for like a sexy answer, like table saw or like one of the sliding compound miter saws or something like that makes a lot of noise and blah blah blah. And maybe that would be, depending on what he really wants to do with this, maybe that would be the best thing to do. But in terms of being able to work individually as an individual person, a bench vise is extremely important because it holds things for you. You know, and this parallel vise does a great job of this as well also, so I don't mock this whatsoever. All right, so now, the part that becomes really critical here is, which way do my 4 degree angles go when I put them on here? So here's how this is. So the 4 degree angles all slope towards the center of the sawhorse here. So that's kind of important for us to do. So I'm going to take my gauge here now, and I'm going to set that to the 4 degree angle that I have on this piece of plywood. So I'm going to loosen it up a little bit, so it's just a little bit friction tight there. And I'll bring that to my 4 degree angle. Ah! This is my song. Songs have a whistle. Whistling them. So like when I get something like that on the radio here, going for it. By the way, this is 88.5 WXPN, University of Pennsylvania Public Radio. Some places in Fleetwood can get it, some places can't, so it's good stuff anyhow. Alright, so my 4 degree angles all go back, setting back. So I will lay those all out. So again, I have my knife. My knife goes right in that little line there. And that comes over. Knife again. there's my knives there, and now to the other side as well. Set my knife in the little cut that I made, that 3.5 cut that I did earlier. Oh, I didn't mark my other 75 there, so I'm just gonna concentrate on this one right here. Okay? So now also I have to go 3/4 inch in. Well, I have the luxury of having a $100 marking gauge that I got for my birthday. You don't have that luxury. But the reality is they're saying I'm gonna go 3/4 inch in. And where do they get that 3/4 inch from? They get it from the thickness of their leg. So I'm actually just gonna set my leg against, and then go ahead and set my marking gauge rather to the thickness of the leg. So right there is the thickness of the leg, and I have those locked. Okay. So now I'm going to mark that along the edge here, and to do that, I want to loosen this up a little bit to raise this up higher. And four a little bit too. Now I'm going to set the mark gauge edge up, and I'm going to come from line to line, and I'm going to cut that. Why is this stuff so important, what we're doing right here? Is because this is going to give you a really crisp edge. You see there's a crisp edge here on both of these? That's a crisp edge that we want to have on this. So that it looks nice and that the board can go in nice and flush to it. So I'm actually going to, at this stage here, I'm going to go ahead and make sure that my lines meet. I want to also, now my body's out of the way of this blade, but I'm going to bring this back with two hands and I'm going to cut a little bit deeper on that. That's that 4-degree angle. You do it in successive passes, though, because if you try to go deep on your first pass, it's going to find the grain and go elsewhere. So you got to be careful with that. So I'm going nice and soft down through there as well. I'll go a little bit more now. Now remember, this one here, this is the wider 3/4. It's going to be angled towards the 3/8. So I'm going to angle my blade just a hair too. Okay? So there's my cutout there that has to be done. So now I'm going to flip it over, I'm going to do the opposite side. This seemed like a lot of work for just laying it out. Actually, one thing I want to do also is I had all those pencil lines there. I'm going to draw some 4-degree lines on that also. So I'm just going to come up from those pencil lines and draw that. So here. I'm going right to the tops of those pencil lines and cutting them. So those would be my four there, and you notice that the widths between all those is a little bit more than what the chisel width is that I'm going to be using, so I can knock them all out very easily. Okay, now I'm going to go to the other side. I'm going to pretty that all up. This guy's a great whistler, isn't he? Although I'd like to take him on head to head, you know? Really see what this guy's got. So I'm still gonna have to go into this little chip out here that we have there. So I want to, eventually I wanna glue that on there a little bit better. So I guess, well, I'm thankful it's not the one I'm working on. I'm working on this one here. So I'm gonna bring this up again, somewhat elevated there, so I can get my marking gauge to it. So now I'm looking at the bottom cut, but it's on my side, so I'm gonna flip this over. I'm sorry, bottom cut's over here. So my angles go back towards the center of it again, so I'll take my 4-degree device here. And what I haven't done yet is those 75-degree angles that came across the edge there. I didn't mark them at the corner yet. So I'm gonna go over to the corner and I'm just gonna mark where those are. What this is doing is it making it visible for me to put my angles on. So I want my 4-degree angles going like this. I'm gonna set my knife in that little spot that I created. And I'll make this cut going back. This cut doesn't have to go back as far, right? It's only a 3/8 one. Okay. So let me show you what I did there. I just put my little 4-degree angles on here. I did a whacked it against the vise or something in my hand. That's what that blood was. I'm all bloody here. All messed up from doing this. See? It's like a warrior. I'm like a warrior here. All right, so I have those marked out. Now I want to mark my 3/8. So to do 3/8, that's just the angle that it comes out at. So I'm just going to do it like this. I'm going to loosen up both of my screws here. And I'm going to bring this to the 3/8 mark on my combination square. These marks have little indentations to them, so you can put the knife right into that spot and lock it. Another way of doing the same thing, if you chose to do this instead, is if I go ahead to like, I'm gonna use this piece right here. And I'm gonna draw, I'm gonna set it to 3/8, cover that 3/8 line, put it to the edge here and draw a little line here. Now if I go ahead and loosen this all up and I push my cutter right into that line, then I can bring this up to the edge there and tighten that. And just check it then and see how it looks. Looks great. Okay, so that's 3/8 perfectly right there. So now I'll mark that on the side. Has to be marked in between those lines, that is 4-degree angle lines that I drew, that I cut on there. Okay, so I'll take my knife now. By the way, this is not a knife cut here. I think I brushed it against the screw of the vise. Cut that. My body's not behind it. You don't cut it like this. Cut it so that the knife has a place to go that does not hit you if it comes through. And now this one gets wider, so when I cut this one, I'm going to go at a little bit of an angle to widen it. Okay. So here's what I have. I have that whole 3/4 side, 3/8 side, all scribed out how I want them. Now I can go ahead and start cutting. So I've got to get this all tightened again. You know, one thing I didn't say was inside these vises here, sometimes there's little things of glue. Just kind of scrape those off easily with your chisel while it's on the table here. Just push them down and knock those off so that they don't put like marks into the pine tops that you guys are using. By the way, that whistling song, that was by Taj Mahal. Taj Mahal is he's someone you might want to check out. Like, check out the song Chevrolet by my man Taj Mahal. Buy you a Chevrolet, buy you a Chevrolet, I'm gonna buy you a Chevrolet, just do something for you. Just do something, I'm in a good mood. This is the last video I'm doing for the week. I've been doing videos all week long, and even though they're not that, they don't take that long to do, they're stressful. You know, I don't do well with stress. So anyways, there we have it. I'm actually gonna shift it over just a hair here.